township left. You're on back. So I'll pass these back real quick.
Captain Tana.
Yes.
Did you have a nice time in New York?
I did, thank you for asking. It was tiring though. So I spent about a half a day actually at the 9/11 memorial, so enhancing my knowledge for this advice. And if I corrected any kind of grammatical type stuff, it was more or less just, I didn't take a lot of points off for any that kind of stuff. It was just kind of more throwing you all a bone and giving you some helpful stuff there. After we're done today, I'll tally up all the briefings, and I'll put those in your cadet mailboxes. The special students, I'll scan your kind of score sheet for the presentation. And I'll send you those, so y'all should know kind of where you're sitting going into the final. Speaking of the final, you might say, "Hey, Captain Pate, with the guest speaker and everything this semester, we didn't get as far as, you know, we didn't finish OIF. Oh my goodness, are you going to test us on that? Would any of you be asking that question?"
No.
No? Yes. I'd be asking that question. So I will answer that question for you. Got it?
I already sent you an email out saying that you did send me.
I already did send you an email.
Yeah, sorry, that's why I would ask the question.
Alright, fair enough. Oh my goodness, you read my emails. Alright. What I'm gonna do is post these for y'all, because I care. This is page one of the samples of behavior from the two reading sections. I will post these on Learn at UW for y'all. Guess which ones you have to know. Oh, very, very good. So there you go. Remember, we didn't get to Bosnia, Kosovo, all that good stuff. So you don't need to know any of that. And the samples of behavior. So, and we only got part of the way through the OIF stuff, but y'all were in class last week. You saw how far we got with the lecture. So I will be hosting the slides. Any extra credit that will be kind of other stuff, like from the readings, maybe that Allied Force kind of stuff, maybe Iraq stuff we didn't fully get to. 35-point final exam, non-cumulative, so you don't have to go back and study all the Vietnam stuff. It, basically, it's going to be Desert Shield, Desert Storm, Northern Watch, Southern Watch, Enduring Freedom, and a little bit of Iraq. Any questions on any of that? Yes.
What was the date on that?
Next week in class, so normal class time. Okay. We will have the final. So y'all have to come here finals week. You can come here during that time slot. I'm not going to be in the classroom, though. I'll be in my office. I'll be like, well, what are they doing here? Cool. Alrighty. We'll get to these presentations here in a second. For all the cadets real quick, just a couple administrative things. I'm going to pass out a sheet. It's a voting sheet for the Professor of Aerospace Studies Award. This is an annual award. So you vote for basically the cadet in your class, so 200, 250, 500 class, who, you know, the most outstanding, most helpful, whatever you think is kind of most deserving of the award, peer voted award. So just circle your choice and just put a short blurb at the bottom why you think they are deserving of this award. So, and then we'll just have you leave these up front at the end of class. So, and I'll catch those other special cadets afterwards. Cool. Any questions before we get started with briefings? What? Oh, no. Sorry, I gave too many. Unless you want to vote on.
Probably not. You don't know many of them.
Schweitzer. Alright, any other questions? Alright, I gotta go grab my stopwatch and I'll be right back. So whoever's up first, you can get ready to go. You don't follow them right now.
notes when you went, did you just use a space bar?
Yeah.
Right, and you stop whenever you're ready.
Morning, Captain Pace. Good morning, fellow classmates. I'm Cadet Third Class Paige Mary Burnclaw, and today I will be briefing you on Francis Gary Powers. In an overview, I will be going over his early life, his involvement in the Air Force, what he did in the U-2 program, how he was captured, and then life afterwards. So in his early life, he was born August 17, 1929 in Kentucky. However, he was raised most of his life in Virginia. Later in life, he attended Milligan College, where he graduated and immediately entered the U.S. Air Force Aviation Cadet Training Program. That was at age 22, and within a year, he showed a lot of excellence and improvement and a lot of potential to be a successful leader. So he was promoted to second lieutenant within not even completing a year of that training. Post that, he was assigned to the 468th Strategic Fighter Squadron at Turner Air Force Base in Georgia, where he was an F-84 Thunderjet pilot, which is this plane down here. And he was assigned to operational flying in the Korean War. However, he was kind of moved in and out of that into Lockheed Air Force Aircraft Company, where he did a lot of testing and helping out doing just a variety of flying with those. He had an opportunity to leave the Air Force, and I say leave just because at this time the CIA and the Air Force did a lot of crossover in programs. So today the position he was in would be covered under like Air Force jobs mostly, but he didn't quite leave the Air Force until later. He had a more professional dismissal, and he went into the U-2 program with the CIA, which was to do secret aerial reconnaissance over Russia, and to specifically, he was in charge of taking photographs of important military sites, missile sites, anything that we could gather information on and benefit us in like a military aspect. During this, he had a cover story that he was employed by NASA on a high altitude sampling and weather research. So if there were race suspicions, he could try to, you know, play it off or make it seem like it was nothing linked to America necessarily in a military fashion. He was flying espionage missions over Russia to, like, specifically over Soviet Warsaw Pact territory. So on May 1st, 1960, he took off from Pakistan on a mission that would just hit about, like, five different specific areas they had notified ahead and land safely in Norway. And it was just going to be a normal mission like he had been doing previously. However, while he was doing these photographs of a missile launch site, he was spotted and shot down by an S-75 Mina, which is this missile in the lower right corner. He was able to safely eject himself out of the aircraft. However, he wasn't able to self-destruct the aircraft or himself, because at the time, each aircraft and pilot themselves had a lot of knowledge and information on board that could be threatening to the U.S. security. So at this time, CIA did provide their pilots with what they called a suicide pill. So the CIA assured the president, President Eisenhower, that neither the plane nor the pilot would be recovered during this crash, because he had the facilities to destroy his aircraft. But as you know, he didn't do this because he immediately hit the ground after he ejected himself and was captured, and went through months and months of interrogation by the KGB. Which he stayed strong through and didn't release information. However, they did force him into admitting of espionage and make a public apology in Russia. So after that, he spent 10 years in Vladimir Central Prison and was only able to leave that because the U.S. made a deal with Russia to do an espionage or a spy swap, is what they called them, with Soviet KGB Colonel Vila Fischer. So they got theirs back, we got ours back, basically, is what happened. So after this capture and crash went down, he went through a lot of debriefs, and a lot of criticism came up because people were really upset that he didn't destroy the aircraft and its classified parts, or take the suicide pill for that matter. And during these debriefs, the pattern of attitudes changed, which is pretty, I think, spectacular, because he quite didn't fill out his mission in the sense that he didn't destroy any information. But once he was appearing before the Senate Armed Service Select Committee, they quoted to say that he was seen as a fine young man under dangerous circumstances. So between debriefs between Air Force, Lockheed, and the CIA, they understood what the mission was and realized and saw that just because he didn't really complete that to the full extent, there was lots of other circumstances surrounding the action. So they weren't as upset about that. But it's unfortunate until it had to take place after his death that he was awarded multiple medals. His family received the Distinguished Flying Cross, the Department of Defense Prisoner of War Medal, and the National Defense Service Medal, which was awarded during the 40th anniversary of the incident. But he was recognized afterwards, so that counts, I guess, for something. But he did, it's kind of ironic that he died by a helicopter crash, because there's still a lot of debate today whether or not he is as heroic as people like to believe he is. Because during his death of the helicopter crash, he did die because it ran out of fuel, and whether or not that was technically his absence to paying attention, or if it was the maintenance that was dealing with this plane not really reading everything right, is still up to subject. So, in conclusion, I went over his early life, his involvement in the Air Force, the U-2 program, his capture, and life after that. Are there any questions? I'd like to say he's a legend of air power, because he showed a lot of swift and quick decision-making skills. Because, I mean, if I was being shot out of the air, I don't know, it depends on the circumstance he was at. Nobody really knows what he was thinking either, but he didn't break down during interrogations or anything, so I think that shows a lot of character.
Was he flying the helicopter when?
Yeah. He was doing brush sweeping or something in California, and he did avoid a playground, so he didn't hit the children when he was crashing, but he did crash and immediately died, which is unfortunate. Are there any other questions? This concludes my briefing.
All right, whoever wants it next. Take it.
Frank, call with you. Click on mine.
Wait.
Is he gonna love me? No, that's to make changes. I can still do it. Okay.
You?
Yes.
Thank you.
Good morning, Captain Payeth. Good morning, fellow classmates. My name is Cadet 3rd Class Josephine G. Langley, and today I will be briefing you on the two bombings in Cambodia. In overview, I'll be going over what the bombings in Cambodia were, the U.S. Air Force involvement, and also the repercussions of these bombings. The bombings in Cambodia was part of Operation Menu, which was begun by President Nixon. However, the bombings did start in 1964 under President Johnson. They were not elevated until 1970 under the order of President Nixon, though, when Project Monday started. But it was a carpet bombing campaign in Cambodia. It involved dropping millions of tons of bombs all across the country. It was intended to shield U.S. forces leaving Vietnam during the Vietnamization period, and also to root out remaining communist forces. When it was under President Johnson, it was mainly just intended to hit communist targets that were thought to be hiding in Cambodia. This is a picture of the bombing areas. The red is where in Cambodia bombs were dropped. You can see it's almost half the country was carpeted. And this is from U.S. Air Force statistics on sites that were bombed, which were released in 2000 by President Clinton. The U.S. Air Force role was that we dropped about 2.7 million tons worth of bombs, in 230,000 sorties or planes and hit about 113,000 sites. In total, that's about 25 tons of bombs per site that they hit. After speaking with President Nixon in 1970, Henry Kissinger was quoted as saying this. He wants a massive bombing campaign in Cambodia. He doesn't want to hear anything. It's an order. It's to be done. Anything that flies on anything that moves, you got that. And this was said to the Deputy Assistant to National Security Affairs, General Alexander Haig, at the time. So it was a direct order from the president to just bomb Cambodia without congressional approval. So U.S. Air Force pilots were ordered to without choice. It made Cambodia the most heavily bombed country in history. There was more bombs dropped on it than total bombs dropped during the entire World War II. And after President Nixon's order in 1970 is when they started using B-52s to help carpet bomb the area. Before that, they were using smaller planes. The repercussions of this war were that Operation Menu was kept a secret from Congress for 4 years, even after the hearings for it began. And it helped to remove some of the presidential powers gained during the war, such as the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution in the later years. The bombing ended up displacing millions of Cambodian people and destroying homes, which helped drive many to join the Khmer Rouge out of desperation, which later would kill 20% of the Cambodian population in the Cambodian genocide, which is about 2 million people through executions and starvation. There's also millions of unexploded ordnances still in Cambodia today, which leaves many people handicapped from explosions that they're still discovering them even today. The knowledge of the secret bombings in Cambodia under Nixon also led to sit-ins across colleges in the U.S. from protests of the secret bombings once information for that was released. In summary, I went over what the bombings in Cambodia were, the U.S. Air Force role, and the repercussions of this. This concludes my briefing. Are there any questions? I also have a picture here. That is a girl displaced by some of the bombings. They unintentionally would hit some villages because they believe them to be hiding places of both Khmer Rouge and Viet Cong soldiers. And then also a flyer to get people to go protest at the White House in the 60s.
Mom, one question for Bruce, at least.
So, only Flint releases information. So, was that because it was like a certain time it got up where you could, or what was the decision? Like, do you know more about that?
Well, usually they keep, like, U.S. military operations, they keep them under wraps and won't release, like, the full information to the public for, like, they have a set year period. And under Clinton, they were able to do that, and it was also a sign of goodwill towards Cambodia, because I believe he went towards the killing fields there. And because in the 80s, still even after the Khmer Rouge was taken out of power, the U.S. relations with Cambodia were still rocky because they'd been freed by Vietnam, so we weren't really ready to discuss things with them. And it wasn't until like about the 90s that they more so stabilized to the nation they are today. So as a sign of goodwill, and because he could, President Clinton released all the U.S. Air Force bombing information during the war in Vietnam and all over into China.
When did you say Congress started finding out more?
I believe it said 1970 or 1971, a dismissed U.S. Air Force major had contacted William Proxmire from Wisconsin, a Wisconsin state senator, and was saying that he felt that the actions they were ordered to do wasn't very lawful. And because of that, that's when Congress found out that what, like, was being done in Cambodia. Because until then, it was more just like a direct presidential order without congressional consultation.
There's some historical kind of perspective that had Watergate not happened, that eventually Nixon may have been impeached kind of just by
going so rogue on the bombings in Cambodia. So
it's so strange. I really talk about this ever. Yeah. Like, I don't.
Alright. It didn't get him out of office, I guess, so.
When the first information about it wasn't Project Menu, Operation Menu hadn't started yet in 1969, but 1969 people had started hearing like rumors of people bombing, but Congress wasn't dealing with that directly yet because it was just like rumors, and that's when the first sit-in started happening like across the country. So, but, like in Arizona, I think, or Kent University, four students were shot by the National Guard during that. Yeah.
Oh, Kennedy might have another question.
Well, I guess, like, it's a question, you know, like, who were we back then? Like, the 60s, 70s. Like, a lot of, like, looking back, I'm not really sure, but if you consider that, like, justifiable, Air Force or any military standard.
I think it was just because we had direct orders from both the president and then the, like, Secretary of Defense and National Security. So they didn't tell, like, more of the higher up generals. It's more just the people flying the planes. They told them, like, this is what you're doing. Don't ask questions. Just go do it. So many people were just following orders. And they were probably just thinking it was communist. Like, they weren't told the full information of what was going on.
So and this was part of, like, the Ho Chi Minh Trail, you know, Rolling Thunder, going after the Ho Chi Minh Trail. So I think that's why at the time they thought it was so justifiable was, you know, yes, we're invading another country's sovereignty, but it's out of military necessity. So kind of interesting to compare that to today, you know, when we're doing these predator strikes or, you know, landing SEAL Team 6 in Pakistan to go after bin Laden. It's kind of a interesting study of, yeah, it's military necessity, but we are invading another country, in a sense, by doing so.
And at the start of the Vietnam War, Cambodia tried to remain neutral with, they had King Sihanouk in charge, and then he realized that the U.S. was going to start coming in anyway, like, we had started dropping some bombs in it, so he made a pact with the North Vietnamese to have them not, they said they wouldn't invade, but the Viet Cong were still coming in, because they were from southern Vietnam, and after that, the U.S. was like, oh, you're going to sign a thing with the North Vietnamese, you're no longer our friends. So that's when they decided they didn't need any, like, confirmation to go bomb there. And also it was because they're trying to protect the South Vietnamese area while they were leaving too. So
all right, who wants to go next? Nobody use PowerPoint anymore.
You have to like pay for it on your computer.
Yeah, I don't have any of the Word stuff on my computer.
Good morning, Captain Page. Good morning, fellow classmates. My name is Cadet Third Class Andrew Dave Fabris, and today I'll be briefing you on airborne forward air control in the Vietnam War. So, as an overview, I'll be going over the history, our brief history of forward air control, the mission in Vietnam, and some of the equipment we used. So, the mission of forward air control is about as old as the air power itself. We kind of used it to get recon, to do recon work, to communicate and to direct like bombardment and artillery. So you can do that with balloons, you can do that with biplanes, you can do it with fighter jets as well. So what made forward air control so important in Vietnam And what made it so much different than World War One or Two? Well, as an example, in Nazi Germany, you have a big chemical plant like this. You probably see it from half a mile away, and you bomb it, and you know what's going on there. In Vietnam, the whole countryside looks like this. You don't really know what's going on in there. Your men could be here, the Viet Cong's here, and they need close air support right away. So, because of the enemy's strategies of guerrilla warfare and then ambush, and then being so intertwined with the community, we needed someone to check out the spot, check out the forest, be able to notice things like more campfires, more farmers, more or less water buffalo in a certain area, or a worn out trail or something like that, or trucks, something like that. And then mark the target for planes going 300 or 400 miles an hour that wouldn't be able to notice those things, and be able to accurately bomb or attack those areas. So what did we use to do that? The first plane we used in the early 60s there was the O-1 Bird Dog. It was really just a civilian Cessna that they kind of outfitted for military use. They chose it because it was super simple and reliable and had steel skin instead of fabric like they had in World War II for similar planes, so it lasted longer. It was able to take off of unimproved airstrips and land on that kind of airstrip too. It was able to kind of cruise at 100 less miles an hour at a low altitude, so it could observe the area really well. And it could do that, just spin around, like buzz around, observing the enemy for hours while the faster jets came, and they could accurately bomb the target. But because it was just a normal airplane, it had some problems. One, it was really slow. It was kind of that was a good thing, but also it meant it was a huge target. If you're just buzzing around, someone's going to shoot at you. It didn't have enough equipment to do night or inclement weather missions. It had like one radio they just threw in the backseat. No armor and no offensive ability besides shooting flares. So they gave you a flak jacket to sit on, so hopefully you didn't get shot through the floor. They gave you a pistol and a Colt AR-15, so that if you got shot down, which you likely would, you weren't immediately destroyed. So they replaced it with another civilian airplane, another Cessna, the O-2 Skymaster. It was a little bit faster. The top speed was around 200 miles an hour. It had equipment to fly at night and during bad weather, and you had the ability to have machine guns or rockets on it. So it's slightly better. But then, in 1969, they introduced the first military design for air control aircraft. This one had ability to carry a lot of weight, including bombs, people on stretchers. It could loiter in an area, buzz around for 3 hours, which is twice what the O-1 could. It was fast. It could fly fully loaded over 200 miles an hour. And it could do crazy maneuvers to avoid rockets and other fire. It was armored and had all kinds of radios, so you could talk to on one, listen on another, and do all this. It was designed with visibility in mind. It had really tough landing gear, so it could land on those airstrips that, or even a grassy field. And it was outfitted with armament so that it could actually do most of the close air support roles that would previously be called in by the Bird Dog or the Skymaster, something like 78 to 98% of the missions it can do by itself. With the buildup of SAMs and AA guns, though, the mission became more and more dangerous for slow, kind of just buzzing around airplanes. So they introduced fast border controllers, which are just jets that do basically the same job. And they use the F-100 Super Saber, F-4 Phantom, and the A-4 Skyhawk during Vietnam War for this. It was also super dangerous for them, too, though. So, in brief, I went over the history of border control, and then I went over the mission Vietnam and some of the equipment they used. Are there any questions?
Cadet Fabris, do they still use any of these planes today?
I don't believe they use any of these particular planes. They still have the mission, but they use kind of more general planes like the AC-130, stuff like that, the F-18. Pepper Club.
When you were discussing the first plane and they're like the slow steel line with the bird dog, is it?
Oh, one bird dog.
Yeah. Would they be out in the air and then they'd like record it was there and then would they bring it back and then they'd go out and
they would find the target, mark it, loiter around there while they're talking on the radio and kind of just wait there or go to the next target if it's kind of stationary. If it moves, they might loiter there till the fighter jet comes there. Fighter jet, you know, blows them up.
So they're both in the air usually.
Yeah.
Okay.
Special.
When you say market, do you mean like a flare?
Yeah, or flares or something like that. Yeah, that's close.
So, fun fact, the OB-10,
that's
correct. they used to have those out at Truax Field over in Madison on the east side, so. Colonel Tom Thomas, who came in to talk, he flew those for a while, so.
I think they're pretty cool. Pretty awesome. Well, this concludes my briefing.
All right, who wants next? Even our non-cadets for last.
Captain Payeth was Colonel Tom Thompson, the one that came in with like the bombs and had like
yep.
the special fire.
Really likes the briefing yesterday. That was
killer.
Yeah.
I turned down the opportunity to fly the force point. Cool, you can start whenever you're ready.
Good morning, Captain Payeth. Good morning, fellow classmates. My name is Cadet Third Class Sarah Lee Smosl, and today I will be briefing you on Ivan Negligen. So in overview, I will be talking about who these women were, the 588th Bomber Regiment, their tactics and equipment that they utilized, and some hindrances that they faced during World War II. So these women were all born in the Soviet era. They were from ages 18 to 25. They all had really big dreams when they were growing up. A lot of them wanted to be pilots or astronauts or things like that. So when World War II started, after their country was invaded by Germany, a lot of them decided to go enlist. And when they did that, there was a lot of biasness because, like, why are women trying to enlist into their military? Because they want to be pilots, and that just seemed really ridiculous to a lot of the people. But they eventually let them in. They went to school for about 8 months, and then after that they graduated, and then they became pilots, but they would not let them fight out in front. So a senior lieutenant, Eugenia Verneva, she wrote a letter to Stalin, and he actually replied personally and said, you can form your own, I want 100% female regiment so that you can lead that, and he really saw potential in these women. So she formed the 588th Bomber Regiment. At first it was really, really small, it only had like 20 people I believe, but then after the first mission, which was on June 8th, 1941, it was a really successful mission, but they only lost one plane. They went and bombed a really important German headquarters. After that, they had 42 additional people join into the regiment, and they flew more than 800 missions and dropped 3,000 tons of bombs. And over the course of the entire war, they only had 30 losses. So the equipment that they used was the Polkovnik PO2. This was originally made as a prop duster plane, and it was really, really poor quality. So their male counterparts said that they wouldn't even fly these planes for recreational purposes. They were made out of canvas. They had a top speed of 90 miles per hour, I believe. They didn't have any type of aviation equipment inside of it, so they had to use compasses, stopwatches, and maps in order to navigate throughout their missions. And also, in order to hold more bombs, they did not have any parachutes. So the tactics that they used, they were very devious. They The way that they would bomb their targets is how they got their name. What they would do is they would sneak up on them during the night, and then they would cut their engines as soon as they got really close to it. And then after that, they would drop their bombs and then start the engines and then take off again. So that's why the Germans thought that the sound that they made after they started their engines again was sounded similar to that of a broom. And that reminds them of witches, I guess. So their targets are mostly like roads and important headquarters and stuff like that. And also, they would, most of the stuff they would do would be for active bombings. So some hindrances that they faced during all their missions were spotlights. Germany introduced spotlights that they decided to surround the targets that they thought that they would bomb. And what the night witches would do is they would fly in, and then they would be immediately spotted. And basically, any little thing that would hit their plane would completely destroy it because of the material that it was made out of. So what they decided to do is that they needed to change their tactics. So instead of only having two planes fly in at a time, they decided to have three of them go. Two of them would go in and distract the spotlights and then split up and make a dark pathway that the third plane would fly through. So then the third plane would not be detected. They would drop their bombs, and then they would switch out so that every single person was able to drop all of their bombs. Some other hindrances that they faced were scrutiny and biases by all the other male counterparts in the military, because they were women and they were looked down upon a lot because people didn't think that they would be able to do anything, because that's just how the Soviets were. There was a general that called them the Skirt Regiment because they initially were issued male uniforms because there weren't really any women that had uniforms before. So then they decided to make their own. They would wear skirts and stuff like that. And also, they kind of laughed in the face of people who would like pick on them because they were women. So then, in order to like encourage this, they would actually drop flowers and other girly things on the sides of their planes. And another thing that they would do that I thought was kind of interesting is they would take like their pencils and their other navigation equipment, and they would like draw makeup on themselves so that they would look more feminine. So in summary, I talked about who these women were, the 588th Bomber Regiment, the equipment and tactics that they used, and the hindrances that they faced during the war. That concludes the slide. Are there any questions?
Were they ever upgraded to different aircraft or anything? So they stuck with?
Mm-hmm. Did they ever get any serious recognition for what they did after World War II?
Yeah, the the woman on the left that she has a couple of us, she was a captain, and she was like, she had like really strong leadership qualities. So actually, Yeltsin had like a big ceremony in her name because she did a really good job at like ignoring all the scrutiny and biases that they had to face. So all these women, that everyone that was part of the Night Witch regiment, was incredibly brave because of the things that they had to deal with, and they were really successful.
Those aircraft they used, were those like left over from like 20?
Yes, sir.
Okay. From the Wright brothers. And read some stuff, kind of speculation too. They had Stalin instituted like a lot of women in the army too, with like snipers and Stalingrad and stuff like that. A lot of it, kind of some speculation I read, was like he was kind of trying to, you know, throw the gauntlet down for like guys, like, hey, you know, kind of, just kind of a cheese mo, like, you know, the women can do it, how come you guys can't do it, sort of thing. So, times were different back then. Alright, you guys gonna duke it out?
That's why I ever giggled. It was like, sorry, I don't like when it, like, you suck. Say it like an American accent.
Yeah, I know. I feel you.
Go for the right. To, just to the left of 79%,
what?
That little pet.
Yeah,
it's just, I'm still in peace.
Good morning, everybody. I'm name is James Danzy, and this is my briefing on the SR-71 Blackbird. So the Blackbird's missing its spy plane. It was developed by Clarence Johnson. Basically, the development of the plane was used for like new aircraft, like the B-2 Spirit, and it has the world record for the fastest manned airborne jet. So the reason why the Blackbird was created was to replace the U-2. The U-2 was basically the spy plane used in the Cold War, the Vietnam War. In 1960, it was shot down by Soviets, by Gary Bowers. And also in 1962, it was also shot down. So the U-2 basically, it wasn't a good plane because it didn't have the ability to avoid radar, and it wasn't fast enough. So the Blackbird was created in California. Basically, they wanted a plane that had three things. They wanted a plane that could fly high, they wanted a plane that was fast, and they wanted a plane that had stealth capabilities. And the Blackbird had all of those. This is the pressure suit used for the Blackbird. Basically, it was used because flying at 2,500 miles per hour created a lot of friction. And basically, the cockpit would probably be around 600 degrees Fahrenheit, so it needed that suit protection. And flying at 85,000 feet, basically, your like blood starts to like boil up, and so it needed that for protection. I don't have any pinpoint mission because obviously it's a spy plane, so it's not really mission. Oh yeah, the plane also retired in 1999 because of costs and satellite.
Well, I have a question.
Do you know like what spy planes use after this one?
Oh, they actually brought back the U-2. They created a different version of it.
Do you know if any SR-71s were ever shot down?
You know, that's a good question. I actually, when I was doing my research, I don't think any were actually shot down because they're like so fast. I mean, they couldn't really catch it.
So with that pressure suit, I heard a story. I don't remember where I read it, but like there was like a leak in one guy's suit one time, and like he came down and but he didn't lose his hand or anything. But like he came down and fell with blood pressure and everything. They said his hand looked like Mickey Mouse's hand. Like when it came down, it was all swollen and weird looking. So you imagine what happened to the whole body.
Pancake.
Michelin man. Cool. Good work.
Yeah,
yeah, if anybody has to leave, you can go now. No, it's fine.
Bye, bird claw.
I'm research the AC-130 gunship. So the AC-130 gunship, officially known as the Lockheed AC-130 gunship, is a heavily armed with fixed-wing side-firing attack aircraft. And basically, what that means is it hovers around the air, uses sensors to find enemies and shoot down. Provide close air support. Used solely by the United States Air Force and was manufactured by Boeing and Lockheed. What is it used for? The close air support, air interdiction, and reconnaissance. The general AC-130. The specific AC-130 types of AC-130s, H, Spectre, used for close air support, air interdiction, reconnaissance, the AC-130U, called the Spooky, heavily armed variant of the Spectre, the J, Ghost Rider, and that was just for, that was a variation on the AC-130 that had very good air flying proficiencies, similar to the MC-13, sorry, 130J, and the AC-130W, which is the Stinger 2, and that was just for flying arsenal and accessories and adventure. And when was it made? It was created during the Vietnam War, and was first made in 1967. And it became, and it began testing in Viet Sath Vietnam Sinatra Air Base in September 21, 1967. And the testing actually went very well, and it was evident that it was a good interdiction and close air support vehicle. Succeeded, and in its creation, it succeeded the AC-47D Spooky under the Gunship 2 program. It's better because it has a bigger gun, more advanced technology like the infrared sensors, flight control, gear system, eliminator, and flight launcher, etc. So the success of the AC-130 is evident because by February of 1968 in Vietnam, it had 43 combat missions, 874 vehicles were destroyed. I mean, and aircraft, I've spotted 212 destroyed, sorry, and 107 damaged. So, post-Vietnam, the AC-130s was also used in the Cold War for superior sensor technologies in Panama, in Grenada, in the Gulf War for close air support, close protection, and battle tradition, and then also in Afghanistan. And the gunship was, well, I guess it's still being used today, so that shows its superiority over other maybe gunships, and it's still being, new types are being developed like this Spooky 2, the Stinger 2, sorry. And here's a quote from the grandfather of the fixed-wing gunship that actually helped charge the Gunship 2 program, and it was that the gunships have been the most effective things the U.S. had for engagements in Panama, Grenada, and Afghanistan, and arguably also Iraq. That should be all. Any questions?
You know how fast it works?
Yeah. Hold on, I have one more question. Actually, no, I don't. I have how high it was when it was the mission, so.
Yes. How high did it fly?
Typically, it was 5,000 feet above ground for AGO. And then for, if there were anti-aircraft, it would fly 6,500 to 8,000 above ground level, and for close air support, it would go down to 3,500. That was pretty interesting.
Do you think an analogy for how destructive it was? Like, there's a building, like 30 seconds, would it not be there anymore?
Yeah, you could say that.
Good answer.
Yeah, it was very destructive. You play Call of Duty.
That's all you have to say was Call of Duty. So the cannon on there, that howitzer, that's like the same kind of cannon that like the army uses for field artillery, and they put it inside an airplane.
Yeah,
it's pretty cool.
There's actually, I had a picture of the inside. Oh no.
Yeah, so that cannon right there, yeah, it's like basically a piece of field artillery on an airplane.
I think what I was really interested in was like ROTC, and someone that was doing work on the AC-130, but it obviously said, like, we hired, like, this old ship. It was, like, really, it's pretty crazy, so.
All right, so like I said, I'll put these in your inboxes hopefully later today. Should have the slides updated, uploaded to Learn at UW. Other than that, send our two non-cadets their score sheets. What else? Oh, and for all the cadets here, hopefully finals week, I'll send an email to make take reins with it. Try to schedule a time. Maybe we can just do a Q&A, like field training session. Or we can just tag that along with the bag drag gates, which y'all still owe me. Yes.
Kevin Payeth, I made a Google Doc for all of us to list our bag drags. So, and then Schultz organized it for all
okay.
of us. So I can send that to you by Friday. I think I told everyone to have it.
Okay. Sounds good. Yeah, we've got to get those on the calendar. And up to about 6, we can do it one time. So cool. And if you just leave those Professor SV Study Award things up here, that would be super. Have a good week. Go right in.
Southeast Asian Refugee class, so when she was 7, I think, they lived on the border with Vietnam.
That was so crazy.